We are live on YouTube. John, do you see us on YouTube? Can you confirm? Chris Bean is also going to speak tonight, so I have not seen him come on yet, so FYI.
And Elizabeth's trying to come on too.
Oh, okay. I do not see her trying to get on.
No, because she needs the link. We can't see everybody.
Are you sending it to her?
Yep. Trisha, can you see what those choices are on the top right?
Speaker is the top one. Gallery is checked. Then show non-video participants is below that. And the last one is exit full screen.
I think we've got everybody on there.
She should be trying.
I should shut that door. Oh, I can shut it. Christian, right here.
Good evening, everybody. I'd like to call this meeting to order. Ms. Goodell, can you call the roll?
Yes. Dr. Anderson?
Here.
Dr. Dimmick?
Here.
Ms. Downs?
Here.
Right. Ms. Litton?
Here.
And Mr. Wright?
Here.
Thank you. Could everybody join me for the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Can I have a motion to adopt the agenda? Ms. Downs?
Chair Litton, I move that the adoption to the agenda be adopted as presented. Thank you.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson. Ms. Goodell,
yes, Dr. Anderson?
Yes.
Dr. Dimmick?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Yes.
And Mr. Reitinger?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Goodell. We will now move on to public comment. Before I start, I need to read our statement on electronic participation. While in a state of emergency remains in effect due to COVID-19, written statements for public comment may be submitted to the clerk for dissemination to school board members. please send written statements to School Board Clerk Marty Goodell at goodellm@fccps.org. Public comments received by 10 a.m. on the day of the meeting will be posted on Board Docs prior to the meeting. Individuals wishing to make public comment virtually during public comment via Zoom must register in advance by emailing School Board Clerk Marty Goodell at goodellm@fccps.org with their name, address, contact information, and topic no later than 5 p.m. the day prior to the meeting. Individuals who indicate they wish to speak will receive an email with a speaker number and information to access the meeting. Individuals will speak in the order of their speaker number. In accordance with School Board Policy BBDH, each speaker will be limited to 3 minutes. Ms. Goodell, has anybody signed a public comment?
Yes, tonight we have 2 speakers for public comment.
Great, thank you. I believe our first speaker is Mr. Jeffrey Shows.
Allowed to speak at this point. So, Mr. Shows, if you want to unmute.
Good evening. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
All right. Good evening. Again, I'm grateful for the opportunity to address you all here tonight, Dr. Noonan and members of the board. I've got my wife here, Sarah. We have 2 small children in the school system here, a daughter who's 6 at Mount Daniel and a son who's 5 at Jesse Thackeray. We are also members of the Paris group that is advocating for a full-time return for all students to the schools. I need to preface this initially that we love the teachers. We need our teachers. We want our teachers. We want our teachers to feel supported, and we want our teachers to feel supported for a full return. So I need to get that out there. There may have been some narrative. I don't want this to be like it's the parents pitted against the teachers. We love our teachers. So I know I've got 3 minutes, so I'm just going to jump into this. How did we get here? Falls Church City used to tout itself as a student-centered school division. Student-centered. It is clearly not that way anymore. Students are no longer the standard by which decisions are made in the school system. They are taking a backseat to other equities, important equities, but they have taken a backseat. It should be about the students first and foremost. My observations on virtual learning doesn't work. Children struggle academically, socially, emotionally. All right, this is the platform is too difficult. Schoology does not work for my kid. It is too much to put at the feet of a K-3 student. Educationally, it's not working. Impacts on children are well documented, all right? Emotionally, we have Governor Northern said it recently in his letter on 5 February, how these kids are being impacted socially and emotionally. Anecdotally, I could tell you seeing my daughter break down in tears, crying, hitting herself in the head when either the platform fails her or she is unable to adeptly maneuver the platform because she's only 6 years old and doesn't know how to do it. And then she tells me she hates herself because she's stupid and she hates school. That is very difficult for a father to see. It is not working. It is failing my daughter and it's failing other kids as well. So why hasn't the school system done anything? All right, we've remained virtual. Why not at least consider K-3? These are the ones who need it the most. These are the ones who struggle the most trying to learn academically, virtually. It's not working. That has not happened. All right. The data supports, the science supports kids can go back to school under 12 years old. All right. They don't contract the disease. They don't spread the disease like adults. The data has shown, study after study has shown, schools opening safely and remaining opening has shown that these schools are not super spreaders. They're just not. All right. And again, we are not going back. All right, I've got stats. Virginia Department of Education, September, over 50% of school districts in Virginia welcomed at a minimum K-3 students back into the classroom for some combination.
3 minutes. Sorry. Thank you, Mr.
3 minutes?
We're at 3 minutes. Thank you so much for your comments. We appreciate it. All right, Ms. Goodell, can we move on to the next comment?
Mr. Crespin is the next speaker.
Can you hear me?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Excellent. Thank you. I'd like to thank the board for the opportunity to make a comment. Madam Chair, When I ran for school board in 2017, I often quoted my grandmother, who told me that the school board is the fundamental unit of our democracy. And I believed it then, and I believe it now. And I ran then because I thought our community and our country needed leaders who understood the role the school board plays as one of the constitutionally mandated governing bodies in our Commonwealth. As the board considers who to appoint to replace Lawrence Webb, I'd like to suggest some criteria for making that decision. The board faces many weighty decisions, from reopening to renaming to reconciling a budget. Rather than focus on positions, how someone would vote on any of these specific issues or any other issues, I suggested the board consider who would make a good colleague. Who of the potential nominees would value process over position, means over ends, because that's what our democracy is all about. It's about following process because we believe in the sanctity of the process, of dialogue and debate. I encourage you to look past whatever positions any of the nominees hold on any of the issues of the moment and focus instead on who will bring diversity of thought, respect for process, and a willingness to engage in a competition of ideas. That's also why I want to recommend Ilya Shapiro for this role. While I may not agree with every position Ilya has or will take, his background as a constitutional lawyer and policy scholar predisposes him to respect process, to put forward well thought out arguments and thoughtfully consider multiple sides in making decisions and adhering to process. And with that, I'd like to thank you for this chat, for your time.
Great, thank you so much for your comment. Just wanna say thank you to both of our speakers. Ms. Goodell, do we have any written comments today?
Yes, we received 7 written comments that were submitted to the school board and they've been posted on board docs.
Great, thank you. All right, we will now move on to our budget public hearing. Before we start, I again need to read our statement on electronic participation. Electronic participation only. Individuals wishing to participate in the budget public hearing number 1 via Zoom must register in advance by emailing school board clerk Marty Goodell at goodellm@fccps.org with their name, address, and contact information no later than 5 p.m. the day prior to the meeting. Individuals who indicate they wish to speak will receive an email with a speaker number and information to access the meeting. Individuals will speak in order of their speaker number. In accordance with school board policy BDDH, each speaker will be limited to 3 minutes. Ms. Goodell, do we have any speakers for the budget hearing?
No one called to sign up for speaking.
All right, then we will move on to the next item. The next item on our agenda is a closed meeting. Can I have a motion to move to closed meeting? Dr. Dimmitt?
All right, is this the long one? So pursuant to the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, I move that the board convene a closed meeting for the following purpose: to discuss or consider the identified subject matter, personnel under section 2.2-3711A1, in particular, staff appointments, staff reassignments, staff resignations, staff retirements, staff performance, staff change in position, staff termination, dependent care leave, long-term medical leave, child care leave requests, and leave of absence, mid-year unpaid leave, and advisory committee appointments.
Thank you, Dr. Dimmitt. Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Downs.
Dr. Anderson?
Yes.
Dr. Dimmitt?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Yes.
And Mr. Reckman?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay, so everyone should have gotten a link for the closed session.
I'm attempting to do that from there.
Are we back up?
I believe so.
All right. Welcome back, everybody. Can I now get a motion to reconvene to open?
Madam Chair, I move we reconvene to open.
Thank you, Mr. Redinger. Can I get a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Downs.
Ms. Cadell, please.
Dr. Anderson?
Yes.
Dr. Dimon?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Yes.
And Mr. Redinger?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, can I have somebody certify the closed meeting? Dr.
Dimmick,
thank you.
Whereas the Falls Church City School Board has convened a closed meeting on this date pursuant to an affirmative recorded vote and in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, and whereas Section 2.2-3711B of the Code of Virginia requires a certification by this school board that such closed meeting was conducted in conformity with Virginia law. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Falls Church City School Board hereby certifies that, to the best of each member's knowledge, only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirement by Virginia law were discussed in the closed meeting to which this certification applies, and only such public business matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
Thank you, Dr. Dimmick. Can I get a second?
Second.
Thank you, Dr. Anderson.
Dr. Anderson?
Yes.
Dr. Dimmick?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Yes.
And Mr. Redinger?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Cadell. All right, next on our agenda is recognition and reports. I think I'm turning that to you, Dr.
Nathan. You are, Chair Litton. Thank you so much. And tonight it's my honor to congratulate all of our school board members. It is School Board Appreciation Month, and specifically this week. And I want to just take a second to thank all of you for your incredible work on behalf of the school system. Normally on this night, we have student artwork that's up on the walls or cards that have been written, but utilizing some of our newfound technology and thinking a little bit more creatively about how we might want to celebrate you this year, we'd like to present you with a brief video. So, Kristen, if you, Ms. Michael, if you let it roll.
I'm Cora, and I'm from the JTP, and I'm four. And I like all the fun things that you did for schools and the fun activities. Hello, members of the school board. I know it's been a very challenging year, and you've had to make some very hard decisions, but thank you for putting kids first. And my mom is actually a special ed teacher, and it's really hard, but everything's going well, and I can't wait to return back to school with them safely.
Hi, I'm Eli. I'm in fifth grade and school council president at TJ. For me and my classmates, thank you to the Falls Church City School Board. I want to especially thank you for making sure those of us with learning differences got special help with that, and for making sure that those of us who needed to come to school and needed extra help with food got that. And of course, for making sure that people who needed to do school from home got that too. Thank you for keeping our teachers and school staff safe. They're really important to all of us. Last, thank you for changing our school name and the high school. It's really important that we have school names that make us all feel safe and equal. We really appreciate it, and we appreciate all of you.
Hi, I'm Melinda Clark Wilson, and I am Mary Ellen Harrison Middle School's Student Council President. On behalf of MEH, I'd like to thank you for all of your efforts you put towards our school system. We appreciate everything you've done for our community. From all of us here at Mary Ellen Henderson, thank you.
This school board appreciation month, we'd like to thank you, the members of the Falls Church City School Board, for everything that you do to make Falls Church City Schools excellent for all students. You are quick to listen to high school students in Falls Church City Schools, especially about renaming and reopening decisions.
You are tireless advocates for us students. You have advocated for and planned for this beautiful new high school building over the past few years.
And as you can see from the learning stairs behind me, it's a really wonderful space to learn.
We make decisions to ensure that every student is safe and welcome in our community.
We ensure that student voices are heard. At school board meetings, when students come to speak during public comment, you always listen to what they have to say. And whenever I say something as the student representative, you're always receptive to my ideas.
It's clear that our voices and experiences matter in FCCPS.
We communicate what's happening not only with the adults in our community, but also with the students.
You are dedicated to your role as leaders, but more so to the guaranteeing and supporting of a, quote, student-centered, innovative, and inclusive community of lifelong learners, the FCCPS mission statement.
We know that being a school board member can be a thankless job, especially during these crazy times.
Your work to make FCCPS the best it can be does not go unnoticed.
But we're grateful for everything that you do, and we hope that you know that we appreciate you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So a few voices there, one in particular that we all know so well. Thank you, Elizabeth Snyder, for your participation in the video. And tonight I get a chance to, and when the rest of you are next time in, have an opportunity to give you a certificate from the Virginia School Boards Association. And it's a certificate of recognition honoring first Laura Downs in appreciation of your dedication and service to excellence in education on behalf of the students of the Commonwealth of Virginia School Board Appreciation Month, February 2021. And that is signed by Janet Turner-Giles and Gina Patterson, the Executive Director of the SBA. And also one for Shannon Litton as well, and school board members who are in the hybrid scenario tonight, we have one for you as well and look forward to giving that to you back in person. But again, on behalf of myself as the superintendent, the staff, and students in the community and in our schools, we just want to thank you for your incredible service. So happy School Board Appreciation Month.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Noonan. And I think from all of us, thank you to all the staff and whoever put that video together. That was really sweet. So kind of overwhelmed by that. It was so sweet. So thank you. Thank you, Elizabeth. So good to hear from you. So we appreciate your efforts on this board and really appreciate your voice. So thanks for everybody, to everybody on that. All right, we'll now move on to our next item, which I believe is our consent agenda. Can I get a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Chair Litton, I move that the school board approve the consent agenda as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Zimmer. Yes.
Dr. Anderson?
Yes.
Dr. Dimmitt?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Yes.
And Mr. Reitinger?
Yes.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Ms. Goodell. All right, we will now move on to Section 8, our business action and information. Dr. Noonan, we don't have Ms. Russell on the line. Do we need to? She was going to
double check.
Join us at some point.
Yep, she is here. Let me promote her real quick. Excellent.
Great, thank you. All right, I think we have everybody here now, and we will move on to our appointment of an interim school board member. So before we get started, I just would like to say, take a minute to say a huge thank you to all of the candidates who put their names forward. I think as a school board, we were really kind of overwhelmed by the number and the quality of people who put their names forward. It was really amazing to see just the depth of people with skills in our community who said they would be willing to do this. So we're really thankful for that. Thank you to everybody who was really willing to put yourself out there. It really meant a lot. I will say that it's been difficult for us to make some decisions on this just because of the wide variety of talents that I think different people would bring. I think we all saw different people bringing different things. We all saw different people that we thought maybe would be good in the position. So, you know, it's taken some work to get to a place where we've been able to decide on somebody to fill the position. So just as a matter of kind of process, the way we will do this is I will open the floor to nominations. And after we have the nominations, we will take a motion to appoint somebody to the position. Then before we vote on that, I will open the floor up to comments by board members. If anybody would like to make comments on the person that's been nominated. So with that, I will go ahead and open the floor for nominations for an interim school board member. Ms. Russell, did I see your hand up? Go ahead.
Yes, Chair Linton, I was wondering if it'd be possible if we need to have some sort of discussion about comments in advance of entertaining motions, or if you want to go straight into entertaining the motions.
I'm going to look to Ms. Minson, who sort of laid out process.
I think at this point there would be a nomination from school board members, a second, and then more nominations. After closing nominations, then there could be a motion. So at this point, the request is for nominations.
Okay, so we should wait on comments and do nominations first. Is that appropriate?
That would be my recommendation, yes.
Okay, Ms. Russell, I believe we're going to start with nominations, but there will definitely be time to comment. Are there any nominations from the floor? Dr. Dimmick.
Thank you, Chair. I would like to nominate Sonia Ruiz Bolaños for the position of school board member.
Thank you, Dr. Dimmick. Do we have a second for the nomination of Sonia Ruiz Bolaños for the position? Second. Okay. Thank you, Ms. Downs. All right, so we have a nomination and a second for Ms. Sonia Ruiz Bolaños for the position. Now I will ask, is there any other nominations? All righty, not hearing any other nominations. At this point, I would welcome a motion.
So you've got a motion and a second, so now it's you can have discussion.
Well, that had been a nomination, not a motion.
Oh, right, excuse me.
So now we need a motion.
Yeah. Yes, that's right.
Okay, so it would be a motion for the school board to approve the nomination of Ms. Sonia Ruiz Bolaños to appoint her to the position.
That is correct, yes.
Okay, sorry, is that everybody? Dr. Dimmick.
I move that the school board approve the nomination of Sonia Ruiz Bolaños to fill a school board vacancy per Code of Virginia, section 24.2-228, and section 24.2-226C.
Great, thank you, Dr. Dimick. Do we have a second?
Second.
Great, thank you, Mr. Reitinger. Okay, now at this point, I will open the floor to comments. Ms. Russell.
Thank you, Chair Litton. So I think I just wanted to do, before we get to the voting, first of all, say that I think that Sonia is an outstanding candidate, and I certainly understand the desire to nominate her. But I do just want to acknowledge the number of emails, first of all, that we got asking, not just in recent times with regard to school reopening, but even dating back to in December, there was a pretty large outcry from the public that our board needed to look at more diversity of thought and include additional voices. And I guess I go back to what Mr. Crispin spoke to in his public comment. I actually had a chance after he did his 3-minute speech, I reached out to Mr. Shapiro just to have a conversation via Zoom and talk to him for a little bit, just because I was intrigued because he was very different and had a different background. And one of the things that I have to say is, first of all, he was a very nice man, very polite, very diplomatic, but I definitely walked away there from it thinking, ugh, because he did not agree with my ideas. We had different opinions on the renaming and a number of different things. But after some further reflection, I realized that that's exactly what we need on this board, that we need people to challenge us, to question our ideas. I don't need another person saying, your idea is great, let's all go along with it. And so I just want to make sure that I'm speaking up and saying not just to the people who've recently written in with regard to school reopening, but even any issue that you feel that the board has left you behind on, that I recognize that this board needs more diversity of thought. And I really hope in the future that that's something we can get and that that's something we can work toward. So I just want to make sure that those people who have written in or commented over the last several months, that I'm acknowledging that we hear you, or at least I hear you, and that I do value that input.
Great, thank you, Ms. Russell. Do we have any other, do you have other thoughts, comments from members? Ms. Bounds,
thank you, Chair Litton. Thank you, Ms. Russell, for your comments. And I know that Ms. Russell and I have had this conversation numerous times about diversity of thought. And I was, for one, I know all of my colleagues were very impressed with the number of, not only the number of candidates who stepped forward, but the impressive nature of their backgrounds. I had people emailing and calling me just saying how amazed they were by just all of the talents that these 11 individuals bring to our community. And I did really appreciate listening to everyone's different perspective and different take on some of the issues facing our school community. And so I do agree diversity of thought is incredibly important and something we need to keep working towards. That said, for me, Dr. Ruiz Bolanos does bring a voice that we don't have on the school board right now, and that is someone who represents our ESOL community. She has firsthand experience. When she first moved to Falls Church City, she reached out to me offering to translate all of our PTA flyers into Spanish so that Spanish students and families could be more engaged with our community. She's also been seen translating for families. She sits on the ESOL Advisory Committee, which is an advisory committee of the school board. And one of the things that we've been talking a lot lately on the school board, on the advisory committee, is that the ESOL community is one of our most impacted groups with virtual learning. And I'm not saying, I know everyone is impacted, but our ESOL community is especially impacted because of their still learning English and they're online at home. So we've been talking about during the pandemic how to better support that population. And Dr. Ruiz Bolanos also was a founding member of our Family Resource Center. And for those of you watching who don't know what that is, it's a resource center that's actually was founded in conjunction with our city colleagues. It's housed in TJ Elementary, but it's actually a city resource center for all families, not just school families. as a way for non-English speaking families to seek resources for any sort of help they might need, financial or otherwise. And she was a founding member and a founding board member of that resource center. So I do think she brings something that we've been lacking in terms of really a voice for that population who is struggling like so many of us are during these times. And, you know, again, I just want to say I really appreciate everyone who stepped forward. And I also, you know, reading through the emails we received today, I think the emails that came in, some community members might have been concerned that if some candidates were more supportive of in-person learning than others. And I just want to just reiterate that this school board is very supportive of our students returning for hybrid learning on February 23rd with the ultimate goal of full-time in-person learning. And so I just want to assure people that that is the goal. And I know Dr. Noonan's going to address that later in this meeting. So again, thank you to everyone who stepped forward. And that's just a little bit to give people sort of my thinking on why I'm supporting Dr. Ruiz Bolanos. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Fans. Do we have other comments? Mr. Reitinger, go ahead.
Thank you very much, Chair Litton. So I'm going to do my best to demonstrate some of the diversity of thought that Ms. Russell mentioned by disagreeing with her to some extent, and not in an unkind way. But what I mean by that is this: I understand the desire for diversity of thought on the school board, and I do think it's important. I mean, I will frankly say that one of the reasons I ran for school board a little over 5 years ago was that I was a little tired of the school board never having dissenting voices. And I think some of us have demonstrated a willingness to dissent on subjects where we disagree. But I also think it's important to pick when we select who school board members are, as opposed to having the community for an interim position select, that we look at what are the most important criteria. And for me, the most important criteria is a demonstrated record and commitment on behalf of the kids in our school system. And I think all of the applicants have a strong desire that came across in all of their discussions, the points that they raised about protecting and advancing the education of our kids. But listening to the comments, looking at the records, I thought the nominee had the strongest record in her service on the ESOL committee, in working as a room parent on behalf of her own children and in helping develop the Family Resource Center than the other candidates did. It's, you know, there are very strong people, but that to me is more important than picking someone who has a particular difference on a particular point of view. And so I will say the candidates' viewpoints on any issues we've considered are not important to me. What is important to me is that she has demonstrated a record of commitment to the kids of the Falls Church City School system. And it is helpful that she helps us with diversity and inclusion because, as Ms. Downs indicated, she will bring forward a voice that we haven't heard before. And that's an important part of diversity as well. And so there were other candidates I thought were extremely strong. For me, it was a very close question of which candidate I thought would be best suited to join the school board. But I'm comfortable in the nomination of Ms. Ruiz Bolanos to be the interim member of the school board for the remainder of the year. And I would also like, as the chair did and others did, to thank everyone who applied. It's humbling to see how many people want to commit to help make the school system better. And to a person, I think all of you want to make the school system better. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Reitinger. Are there other comments? Go ahead, Dr.
Dimick. Thank you, Chair. I agree with what much of what Mr. Reitinger said. When I was
looking at all of the candidates, I was impressed with everyone's backgrounds and the ideas and commitment that that everyone brings to the school system. I personally, in looking at the applicants, was looking for someone who had a demonstrated commitment to the schools, and I found that in Dr. Ruiz Boilanos. And I am happy that so many people applied. Many years when we have local elections in Falls Church, and I've lived here for over 20 years, so I've seen many of these local elections, we don't have people willing to run for office, or we'll have three people running for three seats. So perhaps this fall we will have a robust competition for school board, but and I'm grateful that everyone applied, and would encourage folks to look at the election this fall as another opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Dimmitt. Go ahead, Dr. Anderson.
Thank you, Chair Litton. So I will echo the comments of the others who have said, we've all been very impressed with the number of people who applied and the range of people who applied and the backgrounds of everyone who did. And I want to say thank you to everyone for stepping forward. It takes a lot to put yourself out to the community like that. And we really do appreciate that. I also was very impressed, and it's a close call for me. I had others that I thought would be good candidates too, as Mr. Reitinger said. So I am comfortable, and I have been impressed with the background that Dr. Ruiz Boilanos would bring, as I have been impressed with the background some of the other candidates have as well. I also echo what Vice Chair Downs said about the importance of making sure we are bringing in a voice from a community that we perhaps have not heard as clearly as we need to, and especially now as we are preparing to bring students back into the schools on the 23rd and then beyond into bringing people back in on a basis of full time. Making sure that we are also, as we think about summer and as we think about regaining learning that people may have had deficits in this year, those communities in particular have been affected more strongly even than some of the other communities that we have in our town. So I think it's an important voice to bring in. I also want to say I heard everything that Ms. Russell said, and I agree that she has a very strong point that we need to make sure that we are always seeking out the diversity of opinion, and that we are seeking out those voices that say that we're not making a choice that is necessarily supported by everyone. And I think Mr. Crispin's comments today echoed that a bit too, that it's important to think about respecting process and respecting that diversity of opinion and engagement. So for me, I'm comfortable with the nomination and going forward, but I do respect all of the candidates who have come forward, and I certainly respect the need to make sure that we are hearing those voices that that come from all members in our community and all of our different all of the different angles from which people see the questions that come before us. So
great, thank you, Dr. Anderson. Are there any other comments or thoughts from the board? Anything else? No. Then I will just wrap up by saying, thank you to the board members for this process. It was not clear in the beginning, and I, like some other people, this is not necessarily where I started, and I really thought some other people had some great unique voices that they would bring. But I do think Ms. Ruiz Boilano brings really some very important things to us. And I support the thinking on the board that, we need a voice. We appreciate the work she's done and the voice she's been for our English language learners. And I do think she'll be a great addition to this board. And I would also just like to say, I think, I don't think there's a lot of views in our community right now that people are pro opening schools and not pro opening schools. And I just want to say, I just really don't think that accurately portrays what's going on. I think, honestly, I think all of us are pretty pro, you know, we're all looking at all the factors that need to be considered. So I just want to say, I know it's easy to put people in sort of buckets and categories, but I do think it's much more complicated than that. And what we really need on the board is just people who can really just try and make the best decision possible for our students. So, you know, I think there were a wide variety of people who could have done that. But I think Ms. Ruiz Bolanos is a good, solid choice. And I think we will be well served by having her voice on the board for the next few months. And again, you know, this is a temporary position and we will be heading into elections in the fall where people can again kind of throw their hat in the ring to if they're interested in being a voice on the board. So I think with that, why don't we go ahead and vote on the motion that was brought before us before our comments. So go ahead, Ms. Goodell, can we call the roll?
Yes. Dr. Anderson.
Yes.
Dr. Dimmick.
Yes.
Ms. Downs.
Yes.
Ms. Litton.
Yes.
Mr. Reitinger. And Ms. Russell.
No.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you, everybody. Thanks so much. So I want to say thank you again to the board members and also to all the candidates who put their names in for this. We really had an amazing group of people. We continue to be amazed at this community and people's willingness to speak up and share their voice and share their opinions. You know, I think we're a community where those things make a difference. So thank you for being that voice for everybody who spoke up. And I look forward to working with Ms. Ruiz Bolanos. Thank you. All right, we can move on to our next business and action item 8.02, approval of second reading and adoption of policies. Dr. Nannan.
Thank you, Chair Litton. I'm going to actually pass it right off to Ms. Minton for this agenda item and actually for the next. So.
Very good. Thank you, Dr. Nannan. This evening, we have four policies for second reading. The first of which is GBMA, Support Staff Grievances. This policy had previously been adopted by the board, but is being updated to reflect changes to the Virginia Code at 22.1311. There are no changes proposed from first reading last month. Are there any questions about policy GBMA, Support Staff Grievances? Seeing none, I'll move on to policy GCBE. This is Family Medical Leave Act. This also had previously been adopted by the board and is being amended to add one footnote to make clear who family members are, just so that when staff is bringing questions to HR with this policy, it's clear. And this, the definition that's added at the footnote will be other policies are, as we're now looking at some of our personnel policies, but there were no proposed changes from first reading. Any questions about policy GCBE, family and medical leave? All right, hearing none, the next policy tonight is actually the proposal to remove policy 8.20, Fair Labor Standards Act. This policy exists right now, just says that the school board will follow the federal law, the Fair Labor Standards Act. We also have a corresponding regulation that outlines how we implement the FLSA. At this point, it's our recommendation that you remove the policy. We will be keeping the regulation. And then as we're looking at our regulations and policies in the personnel section, moving from the numbered policies in Section 8 to the lettered policies in Section G, the policy as it exists now in Regulation 8.20 will then, in working with Ms. Hall, who I'm very grateful for her help with this, will eventually be policy or Regulation GAAR. So we will still have a regulation that relates to the Fair Labor Standards Act that tells staff how we implement the law, but we don't need a policy that just says we are going to follow the law. That, of course, we will do. Any questions about the proposal to remove policy 8.20? Hearing none, the final policy for this evening is, again, a removal of a policy. This is policy 8.97, donated sick leave for severe illness of an employee's family member, similar to the last policy. This is going to be moved to a regulation that we've already worked with Dr. Newman on. So as soon as the board, if the board does agree to remove this policy, as soon as this policy is removed, it is word for word being changed to a regulation. So we're not changing what our practice is. We're just organizing this as a regulation under the superintendent's regs and not having it as a policy since there's no corresponding VSBA policy. We will be reformatting it. It will be organized in the letter system and it will look similar to the policies the board has adopted and hopefully make it easier for staff going forward as we're moving towards the VSBA policies to know how this is structured and how it relates to them. But it doesn't change anything functionally that we're doing as it relates to donated sick leave. Any questions about the proposed removal of policy 8.97? And that's all I have for this evening for a second reading.
Great, thank you, Ms. Minson. If there are no further questions on these, could I ask for a motion on second reading and adoption of policies? Dr. Dimick?
I move that the school board approved second reading and adoption of policies GBMA, support staff grievances, and GCBE, family and medical leave, and remove policy 8.20, Fair Labor Standards Act, and policy 8.97, donated sick leave for severe illness of an employee's family member.
Great, thank you. Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Ms. Goodell, can we call the roll?
Yes. Dr. Anderson?
Yes.
Dr. Dimmitt?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Yes.
And Mr. Reitinger?
Great, thank you. All right, we'll now move on to 8.03, approval of first reading of policies.
Thank you. We have three policies for first reading this evening. The first is policy DJB, petty cash funds. This policy would replace the current policy 4.19. I did have a chance to review this with Ms. Michael, and we agree that it's appropriate to move to policy DJB. In fact, it is virtually, other than the very last sentence and changing the wording, flip-flopping from by resolution May to May by resolution, word for word what our current policy is. So it wouldn't change any of our practices. It wouldn't change much of the language at all. It kind of would just allow us to move from the old policy to the new formatting of the new policies. There is a corresponding regulation that we'll make sure that we update and it follows under the regs. But otherwise, what is included in DJB is consistent with what is currently in policy 4.19 and wouldn't change anything. Any questions about this proposed policy for first reading DJB? Right. Then the next policy for first reading tonight is policy DJF. This is a policy that the board had previously adopted in April of 2019. The Virginia code has been amended at 22.1 296.1, and those changes are reflected in policy DJF at those sections that are highlighted in red. So the red font is the additions to the current policy DJF as required by Virginia law. Any questions about the changes to DJF from first reading or from when it was adopted in April to now? Yes, Ms.
Thank you, Ms. Minson. This is just more for you to educate me as an attorney. I do all the background checks for our local Little League. And so we always make sure everyone has been cleared through a, sexual offender criminal database, national database. I was just curious why. So it looks like on here and on that first paragraph, instead of the employees having to sit, be clear that they have not, instead the employer has to come forward if they have been convicted. Am I reading that right? So whether an individual like on line 15 mm-hmm. who will provide such services has been convicted, because it used to say has not. So I just was, if you knew, it just seems sort of strange to me that I guess they just come forward if someone's been, to me it's like the reverse sort of with my work with the Little League, where we clear everyone and make sure they have not. So this is putting the onus on them to come forward if they have, I guess, that's all.
I think in both cases, the contractor, the employee has to say, we are not hiring someone who has been convicted. It's just now they're, instead of saying, our people have not been convicted, they're saying affirmatively, we are not providing services by someone who has been convicted.
So okay. Just, they're so still it's just coming sort of semantics. Yeah. Okay. It seemed odd to me the way, but I understand. Thank you.
But in both cases, there is a statement from
right
the contractor. Right. Yes.
Thank you.
Sure. Any other questions about policy DJF? Seeing none, the final policy for this evening is policy EFB, food services. This policy was also previously adopted by the board in October of 2019. There were some changes to Virginia Code 22.1, 79.7, and an enactment of a new code provision, 22.1207.3:1. So those changes to the codes are reflected now in red here. I have kept the footnotes that the school board put in place, but we are recommending that the footnotes all be removed and the language that is recommended by the board, by the Virginia School Board Association, stay the same. I want to thank Mr. Kane and Ms. Michael for going through this. We've confirmed that there's nothing in changing this policy that will impact what our current practices are. And there is one section at line 77 on page 2 about school-sponsored fundraisers that we are proposing removing, since that language is already reflected word for word in policy JHCF that the board has already adopted. But otherwise, we're proposing all of the changes that the VSBA recommended that are here in red. Any questions about this proposed policy for first reading, policy EFB? Mr. Anderson.
Great. Go ahead, Mr. Anderson. Thank you, Chair Litton. Ms. Minson, I guess I have a question about lines 7 and 8. The way it is currently written, it says employees do not require a student who cannot pay for a meal to do these things. It doesn't seem quite right to me, because to me, I would want it to say they're not permitted to do these things, to ask a student to do these things. I don't think we would want our any student in our schools being put in a position of having any of those things happen. So is it advisable in any way to strengthen that language a bit and say employees of the Falls Church City School Board may not require a student who cannot pay for a meal at school, and et cetera? Not changing any of the rest of the paragraph. That's one question, and I put that out there for the rest of the members also to think about.
That's definitely our intention, is that they are not permitted to do that. So to change that language and make it clear, we certainly support.
I don't know how the other members feel, but I wanted to make sure to raise that one. And I do have also a comment I'd like to say in favor of something that's in the green on page 2, if I can. I really like the idea that, or it's actually page 3, excuse me. I do like the idea that we are stretching the length of time for a negative balance to be dealt with all the way till the end of the school year, and then resolving it through the unpaid, resolving it through the food service program budget. I think that really sort of supports what I would like to see us doing as much as we can to provide flexibility for families who are going to find themselves in this situation. Presumably they're finding it in themselves in this situation for reasons that we want to be as supportive as possible to them.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson. And that language in green on page 3 is an addition to the VSBA language as recommended by Ms. Michael and Mr. Payne. So I'm glad to hear that their good thoughts are ones that the board thinks are appropriate to have in here. As far as your comment on the first line at line 7, if we change the word do to may, it would read employees of the Falls Church City School Board may not require a student who cannot pay for a meal at school or who owes a school meal debt to throw away or discard a meal after it has been served to the student, do chores or other work to pay for such meals, or wear a wristband or hand stamp. Would that change be acceptable to the board members? Would that reflect your what you raised, Mr. Anderson?
It would be in spirit with what I raised, and I'll say that, and then others can chime in as they wish.
Do other board members have any thoughts or comments on that issue?
I agree with that change.
Okay. Then Ms. Minson, since this is first reading, maybe it makes sense to
I also agree.
Okay. Mm-hmm. To make that change, and then we still have second reading for members to go back over it and make sure they agree with that, if
that's okay with all the board members?
Okay. And since normally if there's a change at second reading, we say as amended, we don't need to say that here for first reading because I'll bring any changes to the policies back. I'll make sure I highlight them in red so that we can see the differences between first reading and second reading. And I said Mr. Anderson, I'm sorry, Dr. Anderson.
Either one works, thank you.
Great. Thank you, Ms. Minton. Are there any other questions or thoughts from anybody on the board? All right, if not, I will ask for a motion on approval of first reading of policies.
Chair Litton, I move that the school board approve first reading of policy DJB, petty cash funds, DJF, purchasing procedures, and policy EFB, food services as presented.
Thank you, Ms. Bounds. Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Dr. Anderson.
Yes. Dr. Anderson?
Yes.
Dr. Dimmick?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Yes.
And Mr. Reitinger?
Yes.
Thank you.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
The last vote on second reading, just want to make sure that we reflect Mr. Reitinger's internet was a little unstable, but he is a yes.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you. All right. Thank you again, Ms. Minson. Dr. Noonan, I will turn it over to you for 8.04 school reopening update.
Great. Thank you, Chair Litton, and good evening again, everyone. We are really excited that today we received from the Fairfax County Health Department our vaccination link. So hopefully school board members also got a chance to see that and are signed up to get your vaccine as well, so we can get you into some schools and see some classrooms in action. So we are sort of in the final stretch of our vaccination clinic, which will happen on February 15th at the high school, where we will be able to vaccinate the last folks that are coming in for that. We are on target and are set for a school reopening in a hybrid on the week of February 22nd. And the reason that I keep saying the week of February 22nd is because Monday is going to be a teacher work day, and the first day of school will be the 23rd of February. And in order to ensure that we know exactly who is in and who is maybe making some alternative arrangements, about a week and a half ago, we sent out a survey to all of our staff. And at this point, we've gotten a hold of everyone that's in the division that had not responded. And we have, at this point, 100% participation coming back, and all of our teachers and staff have committed to coming back on the week of February 22nd. So we are very, very pleased about that. So we're in good position that way. When the return to the hybrid, I just want to make sure everybody understands that there are going to be some challenges as we start off, just as though we were starting in September, right? So think about the first week of school in September, or we're in late August, when there are buses that are running late, or cafeterias that are running slow, or kids having a hard time finding their classes. But all of those things that we would experience normally at the beginning of the year will be some of those things that we will be challenged with when our students come back, particularly at the secondary, because for many of our kids, they haven't been in the building at the secondary level at all this year. For the most part, most of our high school kids have come in that are gonna come back, but not all of our middle school kids, many of them. So. I'm confident, though, after about a week or so, we'll be able to hit our stride and be sort of cooking right along. There's a few things that I want to make sure that I hit on that are absolutely remaining vital and key components to our success going forward. And the first is mitigation. So when I mentioned that, you know, social distancing continues to play a key role in our success or for our successful restart into a hybrid. The 6-foot social distance is the gold standard that's been put out by the CDC. And we will work diligently to make sure that we maintain that 6-foot social distancing. All of our kids will be required and staff required to wear masks in the circumstances where there's a developmental disability or a developmental reason that a student shouldn't be wearing a mask or can't wear a mask. Obviously, we'll work with those students in a one-on-one. But we are expecting all of our staff and all of our students to wear masks. Additionally, we have lots and lots of hand sanitizing stations around the schools that have been set up for good hand washing. And then many of our classrooms in the elementary schools also have sinks with hand washing stations as well, and are very excited to be able to work through that. And then also maintaining that we have appropriate PPE for all of our staff. So if anybody needs, you know, an extra mask, or any of our students need an extra mask, we have what we need in terms of PPE. That 6-foot gold standard is important in classrooms, but I do want to remind everybody who's watching tonight that the 6-foot gold standard of social distancing remains for buses. It remains for cafeterias, and it also remains for, as I said before, classrooms, which does in some ways put us in a situation in terms of transportation where it becomes more complex and complicated to transport students, because instead of having 70 students on a bus, we're now limited to traveling with about 20, closer to 20 students per bus. So there may be some modifications to transportation moving forward. The good news is, we're 2.2 square miles and we're not a 25 mile radius around the school division, so we have some opportunity. School mitigation teams are in place and have been trained at each of our school sites at this point. They have not only been trained, but they have actually piloted their tool, their mitigation tool, on a couple of occasions. Those mitigation teams are teachers, our staff, and the like, that will be doing walkthroughs each week to start, to make sure that we are engaged in good, strong mitigation strategies and structures. Just as a very quick anecdote, 2 weeks ago, we did welcome back our seniors for a couple of days at the high school. And the first day was a little bit rough in terms of social distancing. And part of it was there weren't really good structures for us that were put up, or scaffolds, or even visual aids to support our students and where they should sit and where they shouldn't sit. So it was a good opportunity for us to see where some of those pitfalls were. And the next day when they came in, they did a brilliant job, and we're very good in the social distancing process. So on day one, we were probably a C on our mitigation, but the next day we were closer to an A, so that was good. So we'll continue to work diligently to make sure that we have good, strong mitigation structures in place. Mental health is a very important component to our return to school, and I just want to assure everyone that mental health teams that include school counselors, school psychologists, school social workers, case managers for our special needs students are available. Many of them have been in contact with families and will continue to do assessments with students when they do return to school as needed. And then in the case where someone needs to be referred out for mental health services, we will work through the referral process as well. From an academic perspective, which I know we're all quite worried about, and we'll see some data in a couple of weeks at our school board meeting, is that one of the things that we're working diligently on right now is our IRR, which is our intervention, remediation, and recovery programming, particularly at the middle school and high school. And while the students are coming in and working through that intervention process and getting some extra time and support for learning, we do have members of our mental health team available at that time. Because one of the things that we know is that students that have been struggling in this process don't just struggle in the academics, they're also struggling in mental health as well. So I want to just share a few challenges to a full-time return, but I would like to echo a couple of things that were said tonight. And that is, number one thing I want to echo is that we are committed to a full-time return. That's what we all want. We all want to be able to come back and restart school as normally as we possibly can. We don't have a timeline for that yet, because I really believe we need to walk before we can run. An analogy that I've used before is in many ways, we've been in a rehab center, essentially, and we wouldn't ask someone who was in a rehab center to come out of that rehab center and run a marathon right away. We might ask them to take a few steps and to walk. And then as they learn to walk, then they learn to walk faster and jog and then run a marathon. So we know that it's been hard, but we are definitely committed to getting our schools reopened as quickly as we possibly can. And at the end, I'll share a few opportunities that we're thinking about right off the bat. But some challenges remain for us with the full-time return. And first, because of the mitigation requirements that we have, and they have not been softened, it does sound like the CDC is going to come out with some new school guidance within the next couple of days. I'll be anxious to see what the CDC school guidance is about social distancing. I want to tell the entire community, we've read, we followed what the CDC says, we follow what the VDH says, we follow what the WHO says, we've read the studies about school return, and it's a little bit more complicated than that because we are a school system that's hosting 2,800 students, but because of those mitigation strategies still being stringent, we're in a circumstance where there are some significant challenges, particularly to transporting our students to and from school if we were to come back full time. So we may ask some of our parents in some cases to begin transporting their kids. And if that's a possibility, that will certainly help us up our capacity to move forward. We currently don't have really good information about who wants to come back to 5 days a week, as our work today has really been focused on the hybrid return. We know that we've talked to some parents who are very interested in a five-day return. We've talked to many parents who have said they'd like to stay virtual for the remainder of the year. And we have many parents who have said that they want to adopt the hybrid. So when we did a survey, the most recent one, we just surveyed parents about whether or not to be virtual or hybrid. So in due time, we will be administering another survey to determine whether or not parents want to be in virtual or want to be back 5 days a week. I don't envision a scenario where we're going to be able to maintain all three of those different levels of support in a very easy or operational way. So I'm anxious to get that information, but I do know that there are some parents out there that have indicated they're certainly satisfied with the hybrid, but are not interested in a 5 day full return. So we'll also have to navigate some of that as we move ahead. We've done an analysis of our space in our buildings, and we likely have the space we need to return the students who have indicated that they're going to come back. And I know that we can accommodate approximately 80% of our students all at the same time in at least three of the five buildings. And the reason that I say 80% is that on average, about 20% of our families have chosen to stay virtual. So we only need to accommodate for around 80% of our students. The challenge for us is that now we need to figure out in what schools could we support good social distancing and be able to come back. And so when we did vet originally, even in the summer with our staff about bringing students back full time, there were some concerns. And the concerns were, there's so many kids in the class, it'll be too hard to social distance. But, we know more now about the virus than we did then. Our staff have been vaccinated. We have more opportunities to be creative now that we are in it. So we certainly recognize that some of the circumstances have changed. Another challenge is we don't know what's going to happen when we return our students to a hybrid. With our best mitigation strategies, it's virtually certain that we are going to end up with a pause, a quarantine, some sort of disruption in the program. And we'd like to know what some of those challenges are before we move into future planning for a full return. I'm a firm believer in learning by doing and figuring out what do we need to do to modify, adapt, and change to be able to move forward. And so as we return our kids to hybrid with good, strong mitigation strategies, if that's successful and we have very few pauses and very few quarantines and very few disruptions, it gives us some good data and some good information to be able to work from. Staffing does not look like it's necessarily going to be an issue for us in FCCPS because we very strategically vaccinated 20 substitute teachers when we had a chance to vaccinate staff. So we do believe that we have a bench of support that we can deploy when necessary. And further, we have many, many parents who have volunteered to support us through the PTSA and the like. So we will be calling on parents when the time is right to help support us, whether it's monitoring a pod of students, whether it's monitoring a classroom, whether it's monitoring a cafeteria and the like. So we really believe that, you know, this is a community effort. We are truly better together, and it's going to take all of us to make it work. So we are going to be calling on some people to help us. Lastly, one of the challenges is for us is surveillance testing. A lot of schools, private schools in particular, have gone down the road of surveillance testing and testing their students and staff on a routine basis. We currently don't have any support at any level of government in the state or even at the federal level to engage in any kind of surveillance testing. So that's not something that we are looking at this moment. I have been a huge proponent of surveillance testing from the very beginning. I've pushed the health department, I've asked, I've cajoled to no avail. And it's simply because it's not recommended for us to do surveillance testing at this time. But we will continue to monitor what's out there with respect to new products and new protocols that are coming out. We know that things are changing on a weekly basis. So we will continue to look at that. I do want to talk about the summer programs, and I know Mr. Bates is on and has joined us. I'm not going to turn it over to Mr. Bates and throw him under the spotlight here, but I do want you to know that Mr. Bates and his leadership team and the CIA and principals have already begun to meet to discuss what a strong, robust summer program would look like in FCCPS this summer. We know that there are kids that are going to need extra time and support for learning, and we anticipate that it's going to be a targeted approach. So it may not be available to everybody, but we are going to look at the students that need the most support and the most help. And we will work with those students over the summer through intervention, remediation, and recovery. We anticipate also that we will get some funding from the government, our state government, from the governor's office to help support for some of our summer programs. So last week, the governor came out and talked about wanting to have schools open in at least a hybrid by March 15th. We will beat that deadline rather significantly. And we are hopeful that we'll be able to get some funding from the governor's coffers to help with our summer program. I will share with the board and the community that one of the challenges we're going to face is staffing our summer programs. The truth of it is that our teachers are tired and are burned out and want a summer. Not all of them, but many of them. And so we are staff our summer programs with certified teachers, but we're gonna be creative and we're gonna be thoughtful and we're gonna find new ways necessary to make sure that we navigate and negotiate the summer program well. And the bottom line for the board and for the community is that we will have a very good, strong, robust, targeted summer program for our students. So let me just sort of mention a timeline for a full-time return and say it this way, and that is that I'm not prepared to talk about a timeline for a five-day-a-week return for many of the reasons that I recently stated in my comments tonight. I'm not prepared to communicate out what a timeline is going to be. However, we are going to work diligently to maximize the space available in our buildings to get as many students as we can in. We know that the vaccine rollout in Virginia has been pretty good comparatively to other states. We've crossed the 1 million threshold mark in the Commonwealth of Virginia, with 7 million more to go. And as the numbers begin to increase, we anticipate that the numbers of positive cases will subside, and 100,000 cases per 100,000 will more than likely be dropping as well. So as we see the backside of the curve, and as we see the numbers get better, and as our vaccines roll out more smoothly, we can really begin to think about what does it look like for us to bring students back in a more full-time way. The big reason that we want to do it is not just because it's the right thing to do, and we want to get all of our kids back as quickly as we can, but it also gives us a chance to sort of load test or theory test for what it's going to be like with our students in the fall when we return, because we do anticipate in the fall that we will be back in a full-time model with all of our students here in FCCPS. So some immediate next steps that we're beginning to explore, and I'm now in the mode of I'm going to under-promise and over-deliver, because I have been caught a couple of times being excited about something that didn't happen. But I will tell you that we've had very good conversations so far with the high school, to the extent that one possible solution right away is that when we do re-enter the hybrid on February 22nd, we may be able to also invite all of the seniors in at the same time, because half of the seniors will be in class and the other half of the seniors can be doing their online classes somewhere in the building. So we may be able to bring our seniors in right away. On the other end of the spectrum, we are talking with Mount Daniel to see what we can do around bringing all of or more of our kindergarten students back sooner rather than later, not by the 23rd, but when the time is right and we have a good handle on who actually is coming back. We do want to start with our kindergartners, and we've had the same conversation with the third grader with Paul Swanson and Amanda Davis at TJ to talk about what that might look like at Thomas Jefferson. I will share very clearly that my North Star in terms of bringing students back full time is K-1-2-3. I really believe that those young learners need to be back as soon as possible. But again, we've got to walk before we can run. I did have a conversation, just by the way, another group of students, with Angela Atwater, our new interim director at JTP. She's already begun the conversations with her staff, and we're hoping that sooner rather than later, maybe even by the 23rd, we may be able to welcome some of our typical or community peers back to JTP. So if we are able to bring some of our community peers back to JTP, as soon as that, we will. So we are working diligently to get as many kids back as we possibly can. We've been very strategic in ensuring that we have a bench of people in case someone gets ill. We have been working diligently on all of the mitigation strategies. We have videos that have been up. We've trained our staff. We've got our walkthroughs. And at this point, we just need our shot and our kids back. And the reason that we need that second shot is because there is a comfort level among our staff that's really important for them to be able to feel like they can return safely. So with that, Madam Chair, I will end my return to school update, and happy to answer any questions that the board may have.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Noonan, for the update. And I would imagine there are some questions from the board. So I will go ahead and why don't we start with Dr. Dimmitt. Go ahead, Dr. Dimmitt.
Dr. Noonan, thank you for your presentation. It was very thorough and I appreciate it. I first want to say, I will guess, give a shout out maybe. I've been enjoying all the return to school videos. Henderson's done a number of videos. I watched Mary Beth Conley's transportation video today and recommend it to those who have not yet seen it. I have, I guess, a couple questions. My first one I was going to put in the budget bucket, but maybe it fits more here since you brought up summer school. I know that one of the challenges is definitely staffing for us, especially since there's likely to be a lot of competition for teachers for this. If our teachers don't want to do it, you know, it sounds like the governor is suggesting everyone should do this and there will be money for it. I'm wondering, you know, what extra things we can do that would might encourage teachers. I know for myself, when my son was smaller, I didn't take some teaching jobs because the adjunct pay was not going to cover the childcare. I don't know if there's any support we can give teachers there or anything. So that's one question. And then my next question is about indoor sports. Again, I've brought this up before. The CDC recommendation is that proceeding with indoor sports, competing with teams outside of your local area is of the highest risk. The governor's letter echoed the CDC guidance. I recently read the CDC's report on the wrestling competition in Florida that ended up with many positive cases, much spread, and one death. I'm just wondering why we continue to proceed with indoor sports. And I'm also wondering what it looks like. So let's say we have students that compete over a weekend. They go to school in person in their hybrid Tuesday and Wednesday and then show symptoms. How many classrooms are going to have to be quarantined for how much time because of our athletes competing indoors without masks with students in different regions of Virginia? Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Dimmick. Let me answer the first one first, and that is about the summer school and how we might be able to incentivize coming to the city of Falls Church. And one thing I can assure you is that compensation-wise, we're certainly competitive, but that isn't always what gets people to come to the city of Falls Church. And so we will be looking for multiple ways to incentivize, whether it is through childcare, whether it is through other varieties of means necessary to get staff in. One of the things that I do see routinely is that there are school staffing agencies that send me information very routinely that say they have people that are available to come and tutor. But maybe we could transition some of those tutors into summer school folks as well. I had someone bring me a really interesting idea the other day, and that was if we could rent a house that could support, you know, that was big enough to maybe support 8 teachers. This person knew probably 8 teachers from another place across the country that would be happy to come to Falls Church because we pay twice as much as what they pay where they are. So, you know, we want to be as creative as we possibly can sort of moving forward with respect to getting folks in. So I know that that's a conversation Mr. Bates and his team will be having and Ms. Michael for money issues and the like. With respect to the question about VHSL sports and our indoor sports, I'm not sure at this point now that we've sort of talked about it a couple of times, I'm going to be able to get to a point to reconcile it for you, to be perfectly honest. And I really want to. And I don't know. Here's what I do know is that we, with indoor sports and without schools in session, we have had some disruptions to the program. There have been times where some students have had to sit out. There have been some times where some students had to quarantine. And what I can tell you is that we are at the end of our sport season for indoor sports coming up very quickly, with the exception of volleyball. And most sports are moving outside because now we're moving into fall sports, and that will be helpful. So the number of students that will be competing inside when we do return to school is going to be very small. So that will be helpful in and of itself. But I hear you and I understand your concerns, and it's one that has been it's been complex for a variety of reasons for us, quite honestly. And we know safety is of paramount concern. And what we also know is that the students that are participating in sports in very small bubble type groups. And that has actually borne out and been evidenced in who's had to quarantine and who's had to pause. So it was very easy for us to be able to do that. So as far as your second part of your question, you know, if we have a volleyball student who is competing And volleyball is good because it's not a contact sport, so it's less likely to be an issue. But if we have a volleyball student who is competing on a trip and comes back and gets on a bus and starts showing symptoms but has come to school, we have some really good contact tracing methods in place. And we will also continue to do our mitigation monitoring to make sure that if any student is within 6 feet and unmasked, that we resolve that as well, so that there would be a less likely opportunity for spread. I know that's not a satisfactory answer, and I apologize for that.
Thank you.
Great, thanks, Dr. Noonan. Do we have some other questions? Go ahead, Vice Chair.
Thank you, Chair Litton. And Dr. Noonan, thank you for that very thorough presentation. I know that the community was hoping for some more information, both regarding hybrid and the ultimate goal of returning full-time in person. One of the questions I had was about, and this is, as Dr. Dimick said, some of this also overlaps with the budget part of our meeting, but a couple of people said to me, you know, could we use money to rent space if social distancing was an option? I mean, was a problem. And I'm assuming we've got liability issues there. Is that right?
I think there's a lot of issues. Yeah. Sort of, it's fraught with, you know, getting into a lease, moving classrooms. There's some pretty extraordinary costs for that. Finding a space, and then there would be potential liability issues as well. I really believe that we can do it in the schools that we have, and it isn't necessary for us to rent space out. I think it's a matter of figuring out exactly how many kids we have in the building. So I'll give you an example. Today, when I was talking with Tim Kasich, the principal at Mount Daniel, I said, how many kindergarten classes do you have? He said, well, I have seven kindergarten classes, and they're averaging about 22 kids per class. And so I said, okay, so you've got, what is that, 144, you know, is that right? 144, 152 kindergarten kids. And he said, yeah. And I said, okay, so let's run down how many of them are in the morning session, how many of them are in the afternoon session. And when we went through the math, only 114 actually are on site for schooling, because the balance of those students decided to stay home and stay virtual. So because the numbers are so reduced at each of these grade levels, we really feel like we can accommodate them in the school. It's just a matter of us getting in there, seeing the movement patterns, making sure that we can mitigate appropriately, and then we'll start slowly figuring out ways to move into the next phase of our reopening.
Thank you. And that's what, you know, as community members have written in it, and of course, you know, just for those watching, I know I speak with my colleagues and we understand, you know, the challenges our community has faced, and especially with our youngest learners, our ESOL population, and even our older students who might be having challenges of their own. So we definitely understand where the community is coming from, and that people want to try to get back to full-time in-person learning. And you know, that is the ultimate goal. But you know, I've been clear with people too, is I think we need to, this hybrid allows us that time to test our processes and our procedures and make sure that we are good to go before we take that next step. But that is the ultimate goal. And just one other, you know, I'll just put it in there, and that's for Mr. Bates as well. The other piece that I've been hearing a lot of community members is again, I think these are more also from our younger learners, but trying to, parents feel that their students are behind. And I will say, actually, this is actually quite interesting. My fifth grader, I just received his star scores, and there was actually improvement from his fall star scores to winter star scores. So I will say, just in my own perspective, I was pleasantly surprised that he actually has done better over the past couple months and has grown. So thank you, Mary Kay Hughes. But so I know that's, I don't want to steal thunder, and I know we're going to talk about that in a later piece, but just, you know, that is a concern I continue to hear about, is parents just concerned, you know, that, and I'm sure that there will be some sort of assessments, both, you know, at the end of the year and then the beginning of the fall, to check where kids are in the early fall, and that we will make sure that you know, that safety net is there for our students.
Yes, that is correct. And one of the things I may have mentioned the last time, but I'll mention it again, is that when you look at the national STAR data from around the country, one of the things that we're not seeing in the national data, and this includes communities that are impoverished, high Title I to very wealthy communities, more like ours, is that there is not a significant loss in reading. There is, however, some concern in mathematics. So when we get our STAR data presentation next week, one of the things you're likely to see is that our reading and our writing actually is not going to fall off in the aggregate. Now, don't get me wrong, you know, there are some kids that are really struggling, but in the aggregate, you're not going to see a big drop, but there are some things we need to dig into, and I haven't seen the math scores, and we may be just fine in math, but I will tell you from a national perspective, there have been some issues with mathematics. But Jen Fessenden, who's our math coordinator, is working with our teachers to help keep them on track. So thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Pounds. Are there other questions? Go ahead, Mr. Redinger.
I'm happy to be a doctor. I do have a doctor of laws, but normally I don't get that honorific. A quick comment / question. I'm going to move up one of my school or liaison comments to this section, Dr. Noonan. And you may have heard this from Ms. Clinton already, but one of the subjects that came at the day up at the daycare advisory board last night is the desire of parents to know more about the summer program so they can make decisions about what to do around daycare for the summer, because they're sort of locked together and will affect other choices. I know you know that. I would just say, you know, that, and to Mr. Bates as well, that the earlier the decisions can be made and those decisions communicated or the status communicated, I think the easier it'll be for the daycare system and for parents with the daycare system to make decisions about what their summers are going to look like, which could have broader effect in the school system. So thanks very much.
Thank you. Appreciate that comment.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Redinger. Are there other questions or comments? Oh, go ahead, Ms. Snyder.
Thank you. So going back to the point that Ms. Dimmock raised earlier, with sports going on indoors, as we all know, there have been some cases at the high school and some spread, and a lot of students have expressed concern about the possible like quarantines and pauses that might occur in the coming weeks if we continue with both sports that are inside and school at the same time. I know like sports are important, and especially outdoor sports like cross country and golf and everything probably won't have any spread, I hope. But if we're allowing indoor sports to continue, then that might be putting the athletics before this continuity in school that a lot of students have expressed is important, and everyone really wants to be back in school, I think more than they probably ever wanted to be in school. So I think maybe reconsidering the district's position on sports would be welcomed by a lot of students and also athletes. A lot of athletes reached out to me in December when we decided to move forward with sports. I think Dr. Noonan, you might have seen their letter expressing some concerns. And I think those concerns were well-founded then, but they're also pretty well-founded now given what we've seen in the past few weeks.
Thank you. Thanks for that comment.
Great. Thank you, Ms. Snyder. I had a couple of questions if no one else has any. Not seen any. Dr. Noonan, I'd just like to return to, I think Laura, some of her questions kind of touched on this. But I do know, you know, we're hearing from our K-3 parents that they're feeling a bit desperate, I think. You know, so I think you talked a little bit about some of the challenges, but sort of to get back to full time, you know, just trying to understand what some of the challenges might be. You know, if there's space, but we have, you know, like half the kids in a classroom, do we have some sort of vision of what it might look like, you know, with the other half be in a room just with somebody monitoring and they're doing some stuff online? Have we begun to think about, you know, what this could possibly look like if we really made a push to get those kids back?
Yes, we have. We've actually looked at multiple scenarios of what it could look like to have our students back. One of the things that we had initially thought would be floating kids back and forth in the half day program, where perhaps with, you know, if you were an AM student, you would be with your teacher in the morning, in the afternoon, you would go to your special in person, and then the rest of your day might be with a paraprofessional, it might be with a substitute teacher, it might be another opportunity for you to do some independent work. I'm not sure that that's the best solution. I don't know what the best solution is right now. We're sort of just beginning to have these conversations, because I will share that as I raise these questions and sort of push people's thinking, at all levels, I get, can we just get open, please, first, and then can we talk about it? But that was one potential solution. As I indicated before, our numbers are pretty low across the board, particularly in K-3, of students that opted to come back to school. And so what we have also talked about and contemplated is how could we reconfigure some of the classroom spaces that are there to be able to accommodate all the kids. So for example, as an example, at Mount Daniel, has about 14 kids who've opted to come back. So she's got, you know, 8 in the morning and whatever the split is, right? So if we brought all of those kids back into the classroom, could we fit them? And we're fairly confident we could. I think the question is, what does that do to the classroom configuration itself? And how do we need to modify and adapt some of our protocols and processes within the building, so that when you let 14 kids come out from that class and 18 kids come out in the Wingfields class, how do we not make sure that they cross and interfere with each other? So we have been having a lot of like really meaty conversations about what this could look like. So I don't want anybody to think for a second that we haven't, one, been extremely creative in trying to figure out how we may be able to do this, or two, haven't really put our head on it, because we have been, it's one of the things that keeps me up at night, one of the many things, but we definitely are trying to figure it out.
Great. Well, I just think it's important for the community to know, to know you guys are really digging into those details. You know, I think from where we sit, we're hearing a lot of, is there a plan, you know, and I know we say, you're working on a plan, but at the same time, it's, you know, I think it's important, like, for people to know we really are, as a district, working on a plan and looking at those specifics. So
we are, and to sort of say it out loud, it's hard for me to publish a plan on paper without knowing what the consequences of even engaging in a hybrid are first. Or to put something out that doesn't have timelines. So I want to just make sure that everybody understands that the planning is going on, but a lot of it is going to be a result of what we learn by actually doing some of this work. Because if we start having multiple pauses across different class grade levels, different buildings, it could really be impactful to our community. And so I've tried to, as best I can, describe in a circumstance where if we have a kid who's in fourth grade, for example, who comes to school, it turns out he's positive, that whole fourth grade class would need to pause, and the teacher would have to pause. And if the kid rode the bus, everyone on that bus would have to pause. So there are going to be these disruptions that we're going to experience that we're going to have to work through. So it's way better to work through it in a hybrid first before we bring everybody back so that we can see what is the magnitude of some of this. Because someone tonight said that, you know, to paraphrase, that younger kids aren't spreading the virus and don't get the virus. And the truth of it is that they do get the virus and they do spread the virus. They don't do it like adults, particularly younger kids, but we still need to be thoughtful about that. And that's why the 6 feet of mitigation still stands.
Great. Okay, thank you. And I had another question about sort of the idea of kind of a survey of what parents want. But just sort of thinking about, you know, is there a way to sort of ask our community almost if actually doing kind of okay, you know, would you be willing to stay in hybrid so that we can get the people who feel like their kids are in the very worst shape in doing things online, you know, they could have the greatest chance of going back full time. And I don't know exactly how we do that. You know, I'm just wondering if there's some ways we can think creatively of, like, you know, we like to think we serve the individual student. We know that kids are actually all over the place in this situation. You know, like, one kid is fine doing things online. I have other people who tell me it's terrible. It's terrible for my kid. You know what I mean? So, you know, I don't know if there's a way that to do that fairly, but just sort of thinking, like, can we creatively be like, okay, if you feel like your kid is in the most desperate space, you know, can we get that kid back before maybe another kid? You know, and we'd have to ask parents to sort of agree on, you know, where they think their kids are. So
yeah, no, I appreciate that. I think it's very complicated. It's a multivariable calculus problem when you have essentially three different schedules going at the same time for three grade levels at a school. Because you'd have some who are virtual, some who are hybrid, and some who are back full time. So the only way in my mind immediately to be able to work with that would be to completely reshuffle who has which teachers. And so we could carve off, you know, you three teachers are going to teach the full-time kids. You guys are going to teach the kids that come halftime. You guys are going to teach the kids that are virtual. And we could do that, but I think the blowback on that and how those kids then get their encores becomes problematic. It's complex, and they're all riding the same bus anyway, right. On top of it all. So, you know, it is something, you know, we've been thinking about. It's something that we would try to strive to achieve. But in the end, it's much easier to do one. It's much easier to do two than it is to do three. And probably the two would be either, for now, it's virtual and hybrid. And then it would be virtual and full time.
Okay.
So we'll have to.
I mean, that's good to know. That's easier. And then just my last question is, you know, as you look at the high school, you know, and possibly think about, can we bring even all the seniors, you know, what are some of the biggest challenges you're facing now? I'm just thinking about, like, the cafeteria, like, you know, feeding kids, you know, where do you see the biggest challenges being?
In terms of space?
I mean, just in general, as you think about, like, as we increase the number of kids.
Yeah, I think there's three things.
Where the challenges are.
I think three things. One is, this is not a money issue at all. You know, we have the resources necessary to be able to do what we need to do. It's a matter of space and figuring out how to leverage and utilize every space that we have available to us. That does mean culturally making some changes in the way that we do things. So we may need to ask teachers to do They may need to do an encore as a push-in or on a cart or something else to give up their classroom, for example, to be able to do some things. And that's, that cultural shift is not something that can happen overnight. I mean, I can mandate it and we can make it happen, but my preferred method of leadership is to try to work with people and help them come along. So that's really one thing. And then in terms of space also, you know, it's transportation, which is a huge challenge for us. So asking, you know, we are going to ask some of our parents that can drive to drive some of their kids. And then really the last big challenge is not something that we can control. And I don't mean it to push off responsibility, but I will say one of the things that I saw just anecdotally and observationally was that our students at the high school did a great job when they were in school. And as soon as they walked out the front door, they went and they clumped up together and walked off down the street in a group of 15 or 20. So my request of our community is that we figure out a way to translate the great mitigation strategies that are happening in the school and transfer those and translate those into the community as well. Because if we can do it everywhere, we have a much better chance. So I think those are the biggest challenges that we have.
Great.
All right.
Last chance.
Oh.
Yeah,
Dr.
Anderson.
Thank you, Chair Litton. I have some questions I want to ask when we get to the budget chunk, but and I was debating how much of them to bring up. I did have a question on one point, Dr. Noonan, you brought up about surveillance testing. The question I have is this something where the board and potentially the board working with our council colleagues could be effective advocates in some way? Is there an issue that we're just not able to get the surveillance testing support from the health district? Is it a state level issue? Is it something else? And could the board and the council be effective in this, do you think?
So thanks for that question. I think it's a multi-level issue. It's not supported by the CDC. It's not supported by our state government, and it's not supported by our local health district. And the reason for that is that, the main reason is that it can lull you into a false sense of security. So someone may have a negative rapid test who actually is, you know, asymptomatic and is also carrying the virus. So, and then you end up sort of acting on that negative test, and in the end, you end up impacting or affecting others. Now, as I said, I think the tests are getting better. They're more inexpensive. They're coming down in price. And I'm also not opposed to running surveillance testing if that's something that we think will actually make a difference in our capacity to open up schools full time. But right now I don't see that as a barrier, but it is something that we'd like to continue to pay attention to.
Okay, thanks. It may be something, Chair Litton, for us to sort of keep an eye on as to, is there a point in time at which it would be more effective for us to advocate for that if it turns out to be a useful strategy for us as part of our mitigation approach.
It is definitely another tool in the toolbox. And to reiterate an analogy that we shared last time, if you think about layers of Swiss cheese, if you have one mitigation strategy is one piece of Swiss cheese with all the holes, but if you have another mitigation strategy, the holes get smaller. And by the time you layer in five or six pieces of Swiss cheese, there's no holes. So as many of these tools that we can put in our toolbox that represent pieces of Swiss cheese, the better we are going forward.
Thank you.
Anything else, Dr. Anderson? All right, Ms. Snyder, go ahead.
Yes, yeah, so two questions. First, just to clarify, anyone who has the vaccine who is potentially exposed, would those people also quarantine? And then second question, a lot of people at the high school and at the middle school have expressed a desire for more continuity than like 2 days a week. And suggested doing like 4 days on and then like 10 days off for each group so that like contact tracing could potentially be easier. And I was wondering what the rationale was behind the 2 days each week instead of that option.
I'll answer the second one first and then I'll go back to the first one. When we met with the staff and met with family members and communities and teacher leaders at the very beginning of this, actually back in July, one of the things that we heard pretty loudly and clearly was that they wanted to see students at least twice a week and didn't want to go the 10-day off route. There were a couple of people that were doing 4 days on around the state, 4 days on, 10 days off. And that was not an option that was tenable for the vast majority of the people that had reviewed that. So when I think back to the scheduling committee that we had a long time ago, that the reason we landed on the AB schedule was that it would match very closely to sort of what the schedule is that we have now. And if we did end up having to do some sort of quarantining, we'd only have to quarantine half the students, not all the students at the same time. If we ended up having to quarantine everyone for some reason, which I highly doubt will ever happen. I'd like to get some clarification on your first question. What my understanding was, but I want to clarify this because I'm getting some other information whispered in my ear. But my understanding was that once we were vaccinated, that if you were vaccinated, you didn't need to quarantine. But let me double check that and get back to you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Snyder. Any other questions on school reopening? All right. Seeing none, I believe we can move on to our budget work session number 2. Budget question and answers, and I'll turn that back over to you, Dr. Noonan.
Thank you very much. I'm actually going to stop talking for a little while. and thank you for your great questions, by the way. I think it's important to get as much information out as we possibly can with respect to our school reopening and kind of where we are. Oh, Mr. Anderson has to stand up.
Chair Litton, if we're going to be discussing the budget, I should probably, out of an abundance of caution, read my disclosure.
Okay, great idea. Go ahead.
Thank you. I have consulted with the school board attorney and am making the following disclosure of interest pursuant to Virginia Code 2.2-3112B1. Pursuant to Virginia Code 2.2-3115H, I have a personal interest in the school board budget in that my spouse is an employee of the Falls Church City School Board and I am a member of a group of people who are affected by budget decisions. I am able to participate in the transaction fairly, objectively, and in the public interest. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. And I'll turn it over to
Kristen
Michael. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Noonan and the school board. This evening, I'll be going over the budget questions. What I currently have on the screen is a table of contents for our budget questions. And thanks to Michelle Kopic, our budget finance director, she captured all of the questions and the answers that we discussed at our last budget work session. So when you look at the list on the screen, questions 1 through 10 are exactly what we discussed in our last meeting. But we're really hoping that by capturing them, it'll provide good transparency, help us as we move through this budget year and future budget years as well. So knowing that, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to skip to question 11, which is the first new question that we have for this evening. Oops, sorry. So question 11 was regarding the salary increases in surrounding jurisdictions. So we reached out, we participate in the Washington Area Boards of Education, and that group puts together the WABE guide that has budget and staffing data in it each year. Also provides a great resource in terms of getting questions and answers. So Michelle worked with the WABE group to determine the salary increases. So when you look for the jurisdictions in Virginia, only Arlington has not yet released their proposed budget. And they're going to do that on the 25th of this month. The two Maryland jurisdictions, Montgomery and Prince George, we don't have their data. But with the exception of Arlington, we have data from all of the other Virginia jurisdictions. And one of the things that you'll immediately see is, with the exception of Fairfax County Public Schools, every jurisdiction is providing their employees with a step increase as part of their proposed budget. Right, so that's fairly consistent across the region, again, with the exception of Fairfax. Then that next column, COLA, looks at, are they also doing a cost of living adjustment? Alexandria said no, they are doing a one-time payment for the people that are at the top of their salary scale, or people on a hold step. Those are people who don't get a monetary value from stepping. When you look at Fairfax, they did not indicate they're doing a COLA. They are continuing to make an adjustment. Many years ago, their scale for paraprofessionals, which they call instructional assistants, and PHTAs, or an instructional assistant combined with the special ed student care component. Many, many years ago, those salaries were 50% of their teacher salary scale, and they had stopped that methodology, but they're in the third year of a commitment to move back to that methodology. So that is the salary increase they have in their proposed budget. Loudoun, in addition to the step increase, is proposing a 3.5% market adjustment for their administrative, classified, auxiliary, and teacher salary scales, as well as hourly bands. So it's really a large segment of their employees with that 3.5% COLA. Manassas has no COLA. Manassas Park is the one jurisdiction that doesn't use a traditional step salary scale. They do their methodology based on the midpoint. That's the midpoint in the scale. So for their methodology, they're doing a 3% pay raise on the midpoint. That would be equivalent to a step. So that's a 3% basic step. And then they're also shifting the entire scale, which is in fact a COLA, or a market rate or a market scale adjustment of 1.5%. So they have both included. And then Prince William, in addition to the step, they have which is 2.8% on average, they have a 1% COLA. So compared for us, we currently have a 0.5% COLA in our proposed budget, and our average step increase is worth 2.5%. So that gives you data on compensation. Any questions on that? The next question is related to summer school, and I have to thank Dr. Noonan for answering many of these questions in his presentation earlier. So I'm not going to go into them at great length, just because I really do feel that you covered many of them well. So the first talks about funding for summer school. Will it be appropriate to meet our student needs? Do we have the financial resources necessary? And we do, Dr. Nina talked about, we have ongoing funding in our budget each year for our summer program, right? We will apply for any funding that we can get from the governor in terms of meeting that need. And then the other things that we have in terms of our budget is we always have our ending balance, and we have potentially any underspending from this year. Really, this will not be a money problem in terms of supporting summer school. But Dr. Nina did mention that challenge of staffing. And again, we will truly work with our CIA team, curriculum, instruction, achievement, and all of our principals to ensure that fiscally we can support whatever they come up with in terms of supporting our students. So any questions on summer school? The next question has to do with learning loss and additional supports for students. And again, William, the CIA team, and the principals have been working on supporting our students that have additional needs. So this budget question response really talks about some of the things that we're doing in terms of supporting students. When we look at software, we have many software pieces that we used previously. So we've really tried to expand in terms of COVID, in terms of using them to continue to reach students or to improve even more. So this list includes what the name of that software is and who it's targeted for. And then following that, we also talk about other software that we're currently using. And then lastly, we talk about our emotional, mental health and supports for students. So including the staffing that we currently have, resources that we have from Fairfax Community Services Board, which is the Community Services Board. And then lastly, we'll continue to evaluate these needs and ensure that we're using our resources to support students as needed. Any questions on support for students? The next question had to do with our social distancing ability. Dr. Noonan answered this one very, very well earlier this evening. This question really goes through looking at the spacing that we have inside our classrooms and really looking at that percentage of students that are projected to return. So it really walks through each of those things and then addresses some of the concerns that he shared with you earlier this evening as well. So it's really talking about bringing our students back. And then I will go through, I have two more questions and then we'll see if you have any questions. So the next is beginning our hybrid learning program with the ultimate goal of in-person learning. This really talks through, are we ready? And we are on target to return. As Dr. Noonan indicated before, when we prepared this question, we had 90% of our staff committed to return, but we've now heard back from 100% of our staff. So we're very happy and grateful that our staff is willing to return. And he did mention some of the other challenges that we're gonna face. So he talked about transportation, bus movement, bus routes, even just simple things like our Here Comes the Bus application is set up based on our current routes. And because we're gonna continue to run those right up until when we shift to hybrid, we know that it'll take a little bit of time for those Here Comes the Bus updates to load, for example. But we will continue to work through all of those things. So we're committed to ensuring that we can serve students. And we have our COVID mitigation teams in place. We have our PPE. We've been working on supporting students through signs. Great thanks to our Empress of COVID, Rebecca Sharp, who has really worked diligently to ensure that our schools are ready in terms of those resources. Then our question 16, supports for students and learning recovery. This question talks about if we need additional funding, whether it's for psychologists, tutors, or other student support, do we have it? We do have our staffing reserve. This was something that came up in a prior budget question, and our staffing reserve, as well as our reserve for contingencies, could be used to meet any of these needs. So we'll continue to monitor them.
I just wanted to add to the conversation that there was some conversation last night at the city council meeting about some potential and sort of a last transfer of some CARES money, CARES Act funds. And so one of the ways that we've talked about utilizing some of that CARES Act funds to get our schools reopened right away and make sure that would be also to look at some part-time hourly people that could support our kids' social, emotional, and psychological needs, as well as more custodians to do more cleaning and the like. So we're preparing a list of items that we'll send over to Wyatt Shields and Kieran Barwa in the coming week. So we have a little bit of potentially extra funds there.
That was the last budget question. I was going to put the budget calendar up on the screen. And then, of course, we're happy to address or answer any other questions that the board has.
So are there other questions from the board? Ms. Fanny.
Thank you, Chair Litton, and thank you, Ms. Michael. A couple quick questions. One is the staffing reserve. So, once we've been talking about, using hybrid full-time learning, if we were to find once we're in hybrid, we're starting to have lots of contact tracing being needed because of infection. Can we use that? I guess this question's coming up because I just saw that Loudoun County Public Schools is either did or is going to hire a full-time contact tracer. So if we ever got to that point, could we use the staffing reserve to hire a full-time contact tracer if we got to that unfortunate position?
We could. We probably wouldn't use that pot of funding for it. We probably would look at utilizing some other CARES Act funding, some other one-time money. But
we would have some
funding, because
I know that's something that I know is tough on our administrators with the contact tracing. Okay, so there would be some sort of, we could find some money for that.
Yes,
okay, great. And then also, Ms. Michael, I guess this is more of just a request on my question, which I don't even, number 15 at the end, in terms of additional costs and resources, you'll be working on that and so if you could just keep the board posted as you sort of do that deep dive, that would be great. And I guess this question's for you, Chair Litton. I know you were instrumental in getting together, writing a letter lobbying for the federal CARES, I guess, I don't know if it's called CARES, but the COVID relief package, that's a federal package. If you could maybe update the board where we are with that.
Sure, I'd be happy to. The letter did go out to Congressman Beyer and both of our senators last week. I did hear back from two of the offices, just at least saying, we hear you. They didn't promise us anything, but it had been distributed to appropriate staff. And so they know our request. I believe that Wyatt Shields and Cindy Mester were also meeting with Congressman Beyer's office on Friday, and we're going to raise it again. You know, I do know in Congress, these issues are swirling about currently. So that's where it stands. And I think I may follow back up with the folks that did reach out to me and say, we got your message, you know, just to do a follow-up to make sure they are well aware that it's really a high priority to us. So no real answers yet. And I think it's going to be a little while before, I believe March 15th is when really that bill needs to be done, due to some things like unemployment insurance and those things run out. So it's in process still.
Thank you. And I'm going to, Chair Litton, I'm going to prompt you one more time. For those listening, I thought maybe you could explain what we were, the 50% Title I, maybe for folks that are listening.
Sure, I'd be happy to. So with some of the CARES funding that has come out, there's been a couple different formulas, and Dr. Noonan, feel free to jump in here also. I believe some of it has come out more on a per pupil basis versus some has come out only based on Title I. For the City of Falls Church, we don't have a really significant Title I population. So when it's based on that formula, we don't get a whole lot of funding. So what we advocated for was saying, would they consider looking at kind of a 50-50 split? So that it'd be partially based on Title I, because we do believe that funding to neediest kids is extremely important, but also some of it be based on per pupil, because basically all schools across the Commonwealth have needs based on COVID. So that was kind of our thinking behind what we're advocating for. Does that sound correct?
Great. Great, thank you.
All right, any other questions or concerns, thoughts from folks? Dr. Anderson.
Thank you, Chair Litton. So this is sort of a mix of questions that are to deal with things that are one-time needs in the current year versus perhaps next year, and maybe building a little bit on question 15 for that second one. So I guess my question right now on sort of one-time needs in this year, thinking about things like if it turned out that we needed additional supplies, additional PPE, additional resources that for protecting staff and students, but what about also things like if it were necessary to be able to have some space outdoors for food, for instance, if the weather is good and people need to be able to eat someplace outside to be able to bring as many students back ultimately. Are we thinking about these sort of one-time costs and where the funding might be coming from that? Because you generally not a great idea to do one-time costs like that from a general operating fund budget. And I don't know how much the CARES Act funding coming down the pike might be able to help us with that. So I guess that's a first general and kind of long babbly question.
I'll start, and then I'll let Kristen sort of take over. The last tranche of CARES Act funding that we received was about $144,000. And so it's it sounds like a lot, but it really isn't a lot. But it does need to purchase some of those one-time things. With respect to, and just using your example, after talking with the two elementary principals today about the potential for we had purchased outdoor tents already for them to be able to expand their opportunities back in the fall. And so, you know, did they want more tents, for example? And if they did, we have some funding for that. We probably would use that CARES Act funding that we had for those kinds of purchases.
And we did use some of our previous CARES Act funding to really ensure that we had the PPE that we needed in place. So we used it for things like purchasing additional hand sanitizer stations, ensuring that we have at least one face shield for every employee, buying additional masks, gloves, cleaning supplies. So we've really tried to be thoughtful about what we've purchased thus far in terms of using that one-time money to support what we hope are really one-time needs.
Okay, thanks. Chair Litton, I've got a couple others, if I may.
Sure, go ahead.
Thanks. Along the lines of resources to support summer school and additional activities to help with learning and making sure that folks have a chance to get the extra help that they may need. What are we thinking about if we are unable to get funding from the funding that the governor's statement mentioned? Where would we be looking for that sort of one-time resource again, given the idea that pulling that out of an operating budget generally is not a great idea?
So kind of the one advantage we have with summer school is actually in next year's budget, and we didn't run a summer school program this year. We ran limited services, so we will have savings from this year that will be unspent that should we identify that we need additional funding for summer school, that's certainly one option, is to use some of that unspent funding from this year. Dr. Nino, were you gonna add something else? No? Okay, so that is one super targeted, great resource that we could use in terms of one-time funding. But we'll continue to look for other opportunities where we've achieved savings this year, where we can redirect those savings that are one-time to meet these one-time expenditures.
Thank you very much. And I guess the only other question, it's maybe more of a statement, is agreeing with Vice Chair Down's question and wanting to make sure we keep an eye on any additional expenses, particularly in the beginning of FY22, at the start of the fall, if there are, as you're going through the analysis and looking at plans for the fall, looking at plans for bringing everyone back, what additional costs, and making sure that we're keeping an eye on that. So I guess I'm just backing up Vice Chair Down's question on that particular point. So thank you.
Thank you.
Great, thank you, Dr. Anderson. We have other questions, comments, anything? All right. Hearing none, I believe we can move on. All right, our next topics. Do we have any future agenda items that people want to bring up right now? Oh, go ahead.
I would just share with the board that I did send the draft equity plan that you all had sent over to the equity team. And I know Mr. Bates and the division level equity team have had a chance to look at it and they're finalizing their review and any comments that they have. So as soon as I have it, I'll give it to you and then we can perhaps schedule a time to put that on the calendar.
Great, thank you. All right, nothing else on agenda items. All right, we will move on to superintendent's report.
All right, I apologize in advance. This is gonna be a little longer than normal. and the reason is that I wanted to update the board on a couple of things, but first and foremost, I wanted to update you on the school renaming process and where we are. So once you all made your decision to change the two names, that it became a staff obligation to put together two committees with chairs and the like. And I want to share with all of you that we do have two committees now that have been set and established. They are considered school board committees. The high school renaming committee is going to be chaired by Jamie Argento Rodriguez. And then the elementary renaming committee is going to be chaired by Sherry Witt. We've had a number of Zoom calls together and phone calls and emails back and forth. And I will share, I want to thank Mary Beth Connolly, who's been helping me pull all of this together. But before I go on tonight, I wanted to let you know who was on each committee. And I'll also give this to you in writing. So I just wanted to announce it tonight for you and for the community in case there were any questions. So on the high school renaming committee, in addition to Jamie Argento Rodriguez, we have Bill Ackerman, Kamal Bazaz Smith, Georgia Brown, Katie Clinton, Vicki Spencer Ehrlich, Lisa Gross, Eden Hurd, Allison Hira, Jeff Jordan, Kabir Kamba, Edwin Kim, Tom Lovenow, and Andra Popa, Josh, Kristen Ross, Reed Sassman, Elliot Smith, Frank Spinello, Will Stewart, Marvin Wooten, Bell Armino, Chiara, Matteo, Noor, and Stella. I'm not giving the last names of the students to try to help them remain with some anonymity as we move forward. On the elementary school renaming committee, we have Abir Shur Afghan, Brad Allen, Ryan Bork, Marcellus Davis, Kyle Erickson, Aaron Ford, Bethany Henderson, Julie Huber, Lee Johnson, Susan Carney, John Lawrence, Catherine Martin, Brandon McLaughlin, Frank Michici, Jason Polowitz, Will Shorter, Paul Stankovich, Susan Hannah, Hunter, and Truman. I do want to tell you that we had about 80 people apply for both committees combined. And it was a very challenging exercise for us to go through and to provide a very balanced committee with parents, with students, with staff members, and with community members. And also look at it through the lens of gender, race, ethnicity, and the like, and religion, so that we could come up with a very broad range of people on each of these committees. So it was a challenging process, but we were able to do it. Unfortunately, we had to report out to those folks over the weekend that were not selected, but I did want to let everybody know how much I appreciated them applying and coming forward and throwing their hat in the ring. And I'm sorry that we couldn't take everyone, but this is who we've selected. So just to give you a sense of the timing, and we are gonna start this week. So on Wednesday evening, that's tomorrow, I guess. Tomorrow, there will be a Zoom meeting at 7 o'clock for the high school. And that's meeting number one. And on Thursday will be the first meeting of the elementary school. And then those committees will meet every other week on Wednesdays and Thursdays respectively. The meetings will be live streamed on YouTube. So anyone who wants to watch those, they will be on the FCCPS YouTube channel. So you can see the names, the debates, the conversations that are happening. There will be some sort of Google form suggestion template that is likely to come out later this week on the 12th. I do know that the two chairs wanted to run the language by their respective committees this week before they put anything out, but be on the lookout for it in morning announcements, principals' newsletters, PTA newsletters, community groups, and the like. They will then have they'll have a couple more meetings and then an interim update for the school board on March 23rd. So they will come, the two chairs will come and share with you sort of how their process is going, what they're seeing emerge as names. Then they have two more meetings. The fifth meeting is Wednesday and Thursday, April 7th and 8th, respectively, and that's as needed. And then on Friday the 9th, they will submit to the school board in alphabetical order the five top names that the committee has developed. Then on the 13th, Tuesday the 13th, you all will take action as a board. But I do wanna just thank Jamie Argento Rodriguez and Sherry Witt in advance for their incredible work that they're going to do on the committee, but also for their incredible work that they've already done with pulling together histories and PowerPoints and working through how to work through meetings. These are two professionals that know what they're doing, so we're in really good hands. So I just wanted to make sure you all had that to the board and to the community. Other things to be on the lookout for from the superintendent's report, Mitigation Matters is an FCCPS challenge for you as board members, for our staff, and for our community. In the weeks leading up to our hybrid school reopening, we have developed a game board to have fun, to keep track of how well you're mitigating the exposure of COVID-19. And families who thoughtfully plan activities that are in the Mitigation Masters plan and socially distance and wear masks are on their way to becoming experts at mitigation. So here's how it works, is you're gonna get the game board if you haven't already, print it out, keep track of all the things that your family does, enter the form that's linked on the game board, and then the family with the most participation recorded wins some ice cream from Lazy Mike's, socially distanced ice cream at Lazy Mike's, no less. And then the next highest participation will be entered into raffles, and everyone who participates gets an FCCPS hashtag Mitigation Masters certificate emailed to your family. So we do hope that everybody will take a look at that Mitigation Masters game board. It's really a lot of fun. And some of the things are really great on there. High school ribbon cutting. I want to put this date on everybody's calendar. It will be on Sunday, February 21st. It's the Sunday before the week we come back to school. It's going to be at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. It's a perfect time after everybody does their Sunday activities in the morning, whatever those may be, to stop, get a good takeaway lunch, go home and look at the ribbon cutting on February 21st. And be sure when you do get that takeout, you get it from a restaurant right here in the little city of Falls Church. At Jesse Thackery, things with cohort one are going really, really well. Right now, I had a chance to go down the other day and they're working on colors, patterns, and letters. And I have a new favorite song called Colors by Black Pumas. So if you're not familiar with the Black Pumas, look that song up. It's Colors, and it was really a lot of fun. And I got to start my day dancing with three and four-year-olds at JTP. That's the way to get the day started. In case you didn't know, today is the 100th day of school. So century celebrations were planned for students at Mount Daniel. And it certainly was slightly different because it has been a heck of 100 days, no matter how you count it. But I want to just congratulate everybody on getting to the 100th day. At TJ, Give Day ambassadors are doing projects to help their community. Fifth grade ambassadors have been really busy with their uplifting the community group that created a colorful mural on the Oak Street fence. If you haven't been by, it's really something to see. And asking everyone to hang a smiley face or heart in your window. The organ transplant awareness subgroup hosted a bake sale for an organ transplant donation and is holding a blood drive this weekend. The Schools in Need subgroup is hosting a virtual bingo night on Friday, and other groups created meal packs and ran pet supply drives for an animal shelter group as well. So we have some very active students and families right now. And I just take a moment of personal privilege to specifically thank the organ transplant awareness group, because we did have a teacher at Thomas Jefferson who recently did receive an organ transplant. And I saw a great picture of her walking away today. So very excited for that teacher. At Henderson, we had our first Husky Hub Day for sixth graders, and it was a really great success on Monday. About 50 students chose to attend, and they spent the morning at their new school. The next group comes this Friday, and the goal of the Husky Hub Days is to give students a chance to understand and experience the mitigation strategies, practices, and efforts in a 4+ hour mask wearing and social distance session. It's almost like that's what we're doing right now. We're engaging in good stamina building with our masks. At the high school, our 2020 AP Computer Science Female Diversity Award has been awarded to our Computer Diversity Award has been awarded to our high school. for expanding young women's access to AP computer science. This award recognizes the achievement of only 232 schools out of thousands that offer this AP program, and for the work of gender representation during the 2019-2020 school year. I want to send a huge shout out to Mr. Snyder for his leadership and teaching all of our great students about computer science classes, but especially really working towards building gender equity in that particular area. So congratulations to Mr. Snyder. And then lastly, transportation. Getting to and from the secondary campus is going to be a challenge. And thank you, Dr. Dimmock, for watching the video on the transportation. We did put a map together to clearly explain to everyone how to get to and from the campus. We've got lots and lots of bike racks ready. And we have some walking paths that are going to be available too. So I would highly encourage, as the weather gets warmer, to bike and walk whenever possible to the secondary campus, because it will be much easier to get on. But if you haven't had a chance to look at the really great video that Mary Beth Connolly put together, I would highly recommend that you pay attention to that. So I apologize for the length of the superintendent's report tonight, but a lot of stuff happening as we gear up to be ready to go. So with that, I'll turn it over. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Noonan. Ms. Snyder, do you give a call? Oh, no. Sorry, I thought I saw you raise your hand. All right.
Chair Litton, can I ask her a quick question?
Yes, you may.
Thank you, Dr. Noonan. Quick question about the renaming committee when they update us on March 23rd. My understanding is that they will give us, will they give us some examples of names that are more popular that the groups have been thinking? And then also, would they give us some of the history of background of why those names sort of floated to the top at that point?
Yeah, great question. I would anticipate it's going to be fairly organic because we don't know exactly how this is going to flow on these committees. But we did suggest to them, just to not put our thumb on the scale at all, just to say, you know, when you do come give an update to the school board, you might want to just say what's emerging is some of the things, some of the ideas that are coming up. What might some of the buckets be? So is it placemaking? Is it names? Is it, you know, what is it that you're seeing sort of emerge? And then if you would like to know what the genesis of some of those names are, we certainly can ask them to share that as well.
I would appreciate that. I'm sure I speak for my colleagues when I say, you know, I think if we can, the more information that, not to put pressure on the groups, but the more information I think will make us feel good that, you know, they're, according to how we, you know, we all come at it from a different perspective, but just sort of seeing, you know, where they're headed. And I would just hate for us, you know, to get too far down the road and be surprised that, you know, so I think the more, again, not trying to put pressure on them, but the more information and background, I think, would be helpful. And also, if we could get that in board docs before they present, so we could just read through it, that would be helpful.
Of course, we'll shoot for the week before. The one thing we did say to the committee chairs was that was an evening where the school board might give some feedback, like, that's one we can't support. So you might as well eliminate it now before you bring it forward. So they're aware that there may be some that you may just take off the table that night as just not supported.
Right. Right. Thank you. And that's, I think, what I was sort of getting at. I would hate to get to April and then we think, well, four of the five of those are not good for us. You know, so I think, you know, if we can have the more specifics, the better, to make sure everyone's on the same page. Thank you.
Understood. Thank you.
Great. Any other questions for Dr. Noonan from this report? All right, seeing none, we will move on to board and student liaison comments. Let's see, I can start here in the room with Vice Chair Downs.
Thank you, Chair Litton. A couple of quick updates. The Mason PTSA had their meeting last week after the town hall, and they're just working with the staff of the Mason, Matt Hills and his team, trying to support staff and thinking of creative ways to get the students back into the schools. In terms of our ESOL committee meeting, we, one thing, Dr. Noonan and I guess your team, they were advocating for if we could get with that social worker, it would be great if we get a Spanish speaking social worker. I know that's something that would really help our ESOL communities to have social worker fluent in Spanish. And also our ESOL committee talked again about knowing that the budget is tight this year, but keeping that, having that need for a little bit more support at MEH, trying to get the kids ready, algebra ready. And it's, you know, this has been a learning process for me, but one of the biggest barriers to ESOL students graduating is Algebra 1. And so at MEH, they're really trying to get those kids, the students algebra ready. So a little bit more support of that, you know, and understanding the budget's tight this year may need to move on to next year, but keeping it on our list. In terms of our gifted advisory committee, we did find out we do have 3 spots for the Thomas Jefferson Science and Technology High School. So, and the, I guess, minimum requirement to apply for those spots is having completed Algebra 1 and having a 3.5 GPA. And finally, in the, I sat in on the Falls Church Education Foundation meeting the other night, and they are awarding their super grants. And right now, most of those grants, or all of the grants, are going to the high school teachers, and they are reserving some funds and hoping that elementary and middle school teachers will apply for those later on in the year. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Ms. Bounds. Why don't we go to Mr. Reitinger?
Thank you, Chair Litton. I already mentioned the main point that came out of the daycare advisory board meeting last night. I also attended the health and wellness committee advisory committee meeting on January 21st. That meeting was well attended, included updates on the wellness policy, furthering the film series and events on health and wellness, an examination of upcoming wellness resources and conducting a needs assessment. So that's my report. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Reitinger. Why don't we go to Dr. Anderson? Do you have anything to report?
Thank you, Chair Litton. I was unable to attend the Chamber of Commerce board meeting this morning, but I would like to do a shout out to the Scholastic Bowl team for taking second place in the region at their competition last Wednesday. So.
Great. Thank you. And congratulations to them. All right, Ms. Dimmick. Or Dr. Dimmick.
Thank you. I attended the Band Boosters meeting. There is some concern among the band boosters that changes at Henderson that allow students to do a half a year only of band will have negative implications for the overall band program and reduce the numbers of students who decide to pursue band at high school, thereby weakening the high school band program. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Dimmick. Ms. Snyder, did you have anything?
Yes. So a few things. As you already know, the seniors had the option to come back for a day a couple of Fridays ago, and then the juniors came back last Friday, and then the sophomores will be in the building this Friday, and then freshmen the Friday after that. So the feedback that we've been getting from those events is that students really like to be in the building, and we've been trying to get the social distancing implemented, and it's getting better. Some other updates, the High School Social Justice Committee and the Black Student Union are organizing Our History Matters for this month. So you've probably seen the trivia questions in the morning announcements. They also put together this really great calendar of resources for every day in the month. And they're running panels on Monday and then also the following Monday, the first one with like teachers and adults from the community, and then the second panel with students from the middle school and the high school. So those are some really great events to keep on the radar for February. And I guess for reopening, I don't think I have anything else to say. That's my update.
Can I tag on to something that Ms. Snyder mentioned, and that is it is Black History Month, and I want to give a shout out to a couple of people that have been instrumental, not only the Social Justice Committee, but Patrick Garland, who's one of our teachers at the high school, has done an extraordinary job sort of changing how we are working through Black History Month this year to really talk about it as Black history is U.S. history. And so the way that he set up this process of going through Black history allows us to use the same sort of methodology for all of the histories each month. So really digging in nicely, and he took that on as a special project and has done a great job. And so Mr. Bates and I got a chance to do the initial kickoff video that he had put together as one of the starting points. And I just wanted to take a second to thank Patrick Garland for doing that. And just say that this month being Black History Month and really talking about how our history is reflected in that has been huge. So thanks to Mr. Garland.
Great, that's exciting to hear. There's nothing else from folks. Just a couple things I would mention. Now that we have a new board member coming on board, Laura will be doing quite a bit of the work on this, but we may need to shuffle some of our committee assignments. So she'll be in touch with folks on that to figure out what committee assignments will be now that we have a new member. Only other thing I would mention was I was at the elementary PTA meeting last week after the budget update. Just thanks to Jen Beck for running that meeting. It was a great opportunity, I think, for a lot of elementary parents to just kind of express some of how they're feeling. Quite a bit of the conversation was on school reopening. So it was just a good conversation. So appreciate everybody who participated in that. And again, to Jen for keeping it all organized and moving. So she did a great job. That is all I have on that. And we can move on to approval of the minutes. So could we have somebody make a motion on approval of the minutes? Sounds.
Chair Litton, I move that the school board approve the minutes of March 10th, 2020 and February 2nd, 2021 as presented.
Yep.
Second.
Thank you, Dr. Dimmick.
Ms. Goodell. Yes. Dr. Anderson?
Yes.
Dr. Dimmick?
Yes.
Ms. Downs?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Yes.
And Mr. Reitner?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Great, thank you, Ms. Goodell. All right, number 14 is some information on FCCPS enrollment for any members if you need that information. And then we can move on. Before we adjourn, is there any other points of business, any other things that people would like to mention? All right, seeing none, this meeting is adjourned. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you. Good to see you all.